RWBY, Volume 5, the one with all the sitting still and talking. The volume started airing on the Rooster Teeth site on October 14th, 2017, and concluded on January 20th, 2018. Within that runtime of 4 months, we were given 14 episodes, totaling up to 3 hours and 44 minutes. Included in the volume were 3 character shorts. 3 new important characters were introduced, Lionheart, Sienna, and Vernal, while 4 characters were killed off and 10 have been dropped from the main recurring cast, making the total number of important recurring characters 23. So let's start this review with what we were given first. It's nice, and is a fun little addition to getting a glimpse at Weiss and Winter's relationship. It's kinda slow, as the action doesn't really crank up until the 2-minute mark, and then the combat only lasts for 30 seconds before Weiss drops her sword and forgets how to fight. But that aside, it's fun seeing a younger Weiss fight, especially since they couldn't just have her summon for the whole thing. However, the end of the short makes Weiss's sudden breast enlargement super apparent, which will continue to distract and annoy me. Well, not bad, this one is the least rewatchable of the three. Blake's chase sequence is pretty dull, and is ultimately an unrelated visual on top of Ilya's story. Blake is completely incidental to the much more interesting backstory we're getting from Ilya. I can't help but wish Ilya got to tell this to someone in the show proper, as it's pretty vital to understanding her character, and not everyone watches these pre-volume shorts. I like that they finally figured out how to make Menagerie look crowded for this video, but I'm also disappointed that they couldn't get that to follow through to the actual show still. Ying's is also pretty fun, but honestly it does more for RWBY, setting up her hand-to-hand arc of the volume. That aside, it's a fun fight to watch, though the choreography feels pretty rehearsed. It doesn't seem like Ying's reacting to the Ursa, she just seems to be going forward with her attack regardless of what the Grimm does. It's also a little lackluster that the climax of the fight was just one punch. Overall, these three shorts are great. They have smooth animation and bright, poppy colors. The girls all look great, which unfortunately makes me upset that they don't have the same outfits anymore. Though the worst part about these shorts is that they're too good. They're fast and fluid while the show has still clunky animation. These bright colors are missing from the volume, and I'm just left wondering why the show can't look as good as its trailers. Well, it's better than Volume 4's. The characters get to actually move rather than simply standing still in the wind. However, it pretty much is still just a rundown of all the people that feature in the volume. I like that they trick us by putting Vernal with Cinder, utilizing their "oops, we keep spoiling things in the opening" tendencies. The combat's pretty floaty and unimpressive, electing to keep the girls separated despite their reuniting this volume. Casey's pretty hard to understand, as usual, but the melody is exciting enough to pump you up each episode. I guess I would describe the opening as skippable, but not annoying. If you had told me that my favorite arc of Volume 5 would be the one that Blake was the most involved in, I would never have believed you. But yeah, Menagerie's arc was the one I considered to be done the best, though perhaps a more accurate title would be Ilya's arc. While we do tend to follow Blake and Sun around, the two aren't really engaged with the story. They're content to get signatures and sit around drinking daiquiris until Ilya prompts them to join the plot. Meanwhile, Ilya's plenty active. She interrupts the Belladonna's speech and is already showing wavering conviction when the Albane brothers task her with kidnapping Blake. Ilya enacts upon that kidnapping tactfully while also dropping her motivations relatively naturally into the dialogue. While the fight at the mansion was pretty lackluster, it did have its cool moments, and importantly, all that talking that kept stopping to do was in service to pushing Ilya towards the good guy's side. I may feel like Ilya was forgiven too easily, but I'm glad she's part of the friend group now. Menagerie's story had a clear arc with a satisfying ending of the bad guys lost and now Blake can join the main plot. Its biggest downfall is the stupid amount of cliffhangers that riddle the story needlessly. Rather than shoving poorly animated non-fights into episodes 8 and 9, they should have pushed the two scenes together and maybe put some effort into them. But if Menagerie's arc focused on Ilya, then what about... Well, it's not great. While Volume 4 ended with her new goal of take the White Fang back, Blake seems to have forgotten about that by the end of the volume. After getting signatures doesn't work, Blake then has to switch focus to saving her parents. And while I like her speech at the end, the civilian's sudden switch to, "Yeah, let's be revolutionaries," feels a little rushed. But the problem really lies in episode 13. Not content to simply let Blake try to take the White Fang back, the writers decide to throw Adam at her, so now her motivation changes to get even with my shitty ex. And after her multiple victories against him, they decide, wait, we need him to be a villain in future volumes still, and just have Blake let him run away. While it's fun getting to see her complete the reunion of Team RWBY, it also came at the cost of her whole arc being dropped. Taking the White Fang back was just a facade to get her to Haven, conveniently at the same time as her friends. If the others sisters hadn't have been there, it's not unreasonable to think Blake would have just continued to do White Fang stuff with her family. She only rejoins the girls because they happen to be there. The characters all act like taking down this one branch of the group has totally eradicated the terrorist aspect of the White Fang. If that's true, I don't understand why the Belladonnas hadn't taken it back before now. Blake spent the last two volumes doing nothing important. She sat around her house and then went to Haven so her parents and son could do her task of take the gang back. She's been completely separated from the main plot and has only mentioned her group in passing. It's a shame that they didn't try to keep Blake involved in the main story at all, and instead elected to just have her do her own individual thing while the rest of the team got to deal with the real plot of the show. Setting up Yang's PTSD has meant nothing. Her hand shakes when it's aesthetically pleasing. Punches guy, hand shakes. Mad about Blake, hand shakes. It only happens to punctuate moments of anger, and that's it. When Raven calls out her shaking in the vault, I hadn't realized this was supposed to be her PTSD. I thought she was just scared.
Who do you think you are lecturing me? Standing there shaking like a scared little girl.
The shaking's been incidental and is the only symptom of PTSD Yang seems to still have. Rather than have Yang work through all the different struggles of PTSD, they just go with a small hand shimmy. The trauma of Beacon and her dismemberment has left no ill effects on her emotional or mental state. Her nightmares seem to be gone and all of her confidence is back, so with those potential arcs dropped, all that's left is finding her mom, and what a fumble that was. Yang only finds her mom because the plot needed her to, so she could get to Haven. Whatever reason Yang started looking for her when she was little has been thrown out the window. Why was she looking for her in her original trailer? Doesn't matter anymore, cause now she's looking for Raven so she can take her to RWBY.
I'm not here for you. RWBY is somewhere in Mistral. I just need you to take me to her.
Raven transforms from Yang's long-running goal to a gimmick to reunite the girls. Yang's taken her own motivation of, I want to find mom, and just replaced it with, I want to get back to RWBY. Why was this set up back in Volume 2 if this is the payoff? Yang finding her in the vault was also incidental. Yang had showed no interest in Raven throughout the fight, seeming significantly more preoccupied with Emerald and Mercury. RWBY arbitrarily tells Yang to chase after the villains for no reason, and elects for Yang to go alone simply because the script said so. Yang dissing her mom is touted as being a big climax for her arc, but it's rambly nonsense. Yang's motivations all petered away with her switch to get me to RWBY, and so her final conversation with Raven lacks any sort of intent or reasoning. Yang fulfills her goal of find mom in episode 4, and then spends an episode listening to Raven drop exposition until she immediately completes her new goal of find RWBY in episode 6. The rest of the volume, she just spends her time sitting around the house with the others. Her breakdown with Weiss was totally unnecessary and furthered nothing with the girls' shift in topic to Weiss's backstory. She didn't grow from it, and it made no impact on anything. All the scene did was waste time learning about Weiss's relationship with her mom. Yang has nothing to do all volume, and is only the one to go down to get the relic because someone had to yell at Raven for being a meanie. RWBY and Weiss don't really have arcs this volume. Getting kidnapped was just a means to have Weiss get to Haven quickly with Yang. She got to help Yang through her problems, which was nice, but her biggest role was to almost die so Jean could activate his semblance. For the most part, Weiss just plays support for the volume, which I'm fine with. Of the RWBY girls, Weiss has gotten to develop the most so far, so it's okay that she doesn't have any goals outside of get to my friends this time around. RWBY, on the other hand, not so much. Despite her small role for volumes 2, 3, and 4, RWBY still doesn't get an arc. They set one up for her, working on her hand-to-hand combat, but that gets dropped after one scene. Of the main four girls, RWBY is the least active, as she doesn't even get to spend time traveling like Yang and Weiss. RWBY starts the volume reaching the destination, and then spends 14 episodes doing nothing. She spends most of that time sitting around the house. While Weiss gets to help with other character arcs by talking with Yang and getting Jean to learn to heal, RWBY doesn't. The closest she gets is when she has a talk with Oscar, but rather than developing either of the two, RWBY just goes over prior events we've already seen. Once the finale kicks off, RWBY spends half the fight out cold and makes just as much of an impact on the encounter once she wakes up. They cut away from every battle she partakes in, lingering just long enough to show us that they jumped over her hand-to-hand arc and is now competent enough to headbutt Mercury. The most important thing RWBY gets to do for the volume is act as a waymarker for Yang and Weiss to teleport to. Good job. You've made your title character the least important figure in the cast, again. They gave Oscar the setup for an arc that never gets done, and made Jean jump to the conclusion of an arc that never happened. They had set up plenty for Oscar to do. He needs to learn to remember to activate his aura. We see him training alone, implying that we could get an arc of him learning to fight better. He has an ancient voice in his head and is a new addition to a cast. Simply letting Oscar interact with the others would allow the writers to flesh out his character, while also allowing him to be assimilated into the friend group. But instead, the writers just make Ozpin take over all the time. After his training in episode 3, Oscar only makes minor appearances to initiate conversations with Crow and get flustered around the girls. And once the final battle rolls around, Ozpin forces himself into the lead, meaning we don't really get to see Oscar fight. Why bring up all these ways for Oscar to grow just to never utilize him? He's a brand new and very important member of the cast, and yet he's totally ignored. Meanwhile, Jean gets to play an important role in the finale out of the blue. Mentioning his lack of semblance 10 episodes before it happens doesn't count as setting it up, or at least doesn't count as setting it up well. His saving Weiss is treated like a huge event, but it comes out of nowhere and it doesn't last. The moment Weiss is up again, he and his team vanish from the encounter. There's all this build-up and tension for a scene that gets interrupted with an elevator ride, and is then put into the background as Blake takes center stage talking to Adam. This was an important development. Why wouldn't they lead into it during the volume? And why wouldn't they linger on it once it happens? Haven's arc makes up the bulk of the finale. It's the biggest problem the girls all need to worry about, and it's what the villains are working towards throughout the volume. By all accounts, the events at Haven should be considered the main plot of the volume. And it sucks. Despite being a center point for all the villainy, nothing happens at Haven for 10 whole episodes. This means the kids spend an entire volume sitting on their asses waiting for the writers to let the story continue, and sprinkled throughout are either non-existent character arcs or long-winded exposition dumps. RWBY gets one scene of training. Oscar admits to being scared so RWBY can remind the audience that Pyrrha died. Crow spends half an episode in the rain so it could be clear there are no huntsmen left. The gang sit around eating while also just telling each other what we've already seen. Oscar and Ozpin talk about lore and shit almost constantly. These scenes could have been great for character building, but instead get wasted on unnecessary recap or boringly drawn out lore explanations. The closest we get to something actually happening at Haven is when Yang and Weiss talk. They had all the setup for the two to become closer friends and help each other grow as characters, but then they fumble it up and just have the two drop their background information onto each other. The scene did everything it could to avoid the conflict it had originally addressed, Yang being upset at Blake. And ultimately, the events of the scene didn't matter. Alcoholism isn't touched on in the volume, we still never get to see Weiss's mom, and Blake doesn't interact with Yang again until the last couple minutes of the volume. The closest they get to having something happen is an unnecessary scene. Were someone to skip the whole conversation, then they would have only lost out on some ham-fistedly explained backstory around Weiss's mom, and that's it. For the whole volume, the cast has nothing to do aside from sit around and scream jokes at each other, until RD decides to let something progress again in episode 11. Suddenly everyone's treating this like it's serious business, just for them to fuck this up too. After the lackadaisical mood of the volume, the prospect of an 18-person mega-fight sounds like an exciting way to finish off the volume, but instead we get 4 episodes full of clunky line reads, characters' IQs plummeting to allow plot-convenient events to occur, boatloads of continued backstory and lore dumps, mishandled character arcs with no setup or conclusion, contrived excuses to force the heroes into a victory, and the director's inability to put a level of tension into any of the conflict without resorting to a cheap cliffhanger. And on top of it all, it seems the crew had blown all their resources on throwing the first episode of the volume into theaters, because they do their damnedest to make sure there's as little movement on screen as possible. All the characters develop the tendency to just stand around talking to each other or breathing heavy. Getting to see most of the fights is stolen from the viewer to instead be forced to watch other characters stand still and talk. Despite all the conflicts happening, there's always a different group of people not participating in the action that we have to watch instead. Haven's arc boils down to wasted screen time. Rather than watch the characters grow, train, or develop, we have to listen to boring exposition. Rather than have a bombastic, exciting fight to end the volume, we jump away from every encounter so characters can talk to each other calmly. The villains are an interesting topic for this volume because they're kind of the only ones who are actively trying to do something. While the heroes are content to just wait for the plot to get moving and drink beverages, the baddies are really putting in the effort to have something happen during the volume. Some will probably say that Raven's an anti-hero, not a villain, but she's villainous enough to try to kidnap one of our main characters, so this is where I'll put her. When Raven had originally said that she was going to try to take the relic, I was damn excited. There's a lot of intrigue in a double cross, and I figured it would be fun seeing how she planned to go about that. However, that excitement diminished significantly once Raven forgot why she had wanted the relic in the first place and just let Yang take it without any resistance. Hazel and Adam are sort of non-entities who just show up in the final battle because there were too many heroes to deal with. They don't affect the plot in any way. Hazel only matters in that he's the thing keeping the kids from winning right away at Haven. And Adam just shows up because Blake needed someone to win against. Him taking Sienna's throne did nothing. He's already been shown to have leagues of White Fang members at his disposal. Gaining the title of leader gave him no more power than he already had. Murdering Sienna was disappointing not just because she looked cool, but also because it didn't matter. Remove the scene from the volume and nothing changes. Cinder continues to annoy me with her incessant snarking, but the biggest problem with her is how the show treats her like she's really important while never using her to facilitate the heroes. She boils down to being the one who killed Pyrrha for half the finale. She's just the outlet for Jean to get to yell at. Stabbing Weiss should have been a big deal, but the rushed nature of the event renders it lackluster. Cinder seems to have no character beyond, "I love power," and no motivations beyond, "I want power." Sometimes she seems to have a huge hate boner for RWBY, but then when she's able to confront her, Cinder ignores RWBY entirely. And worst of all, despite the fact that she's the longest running villain of the series so far, the only villain we've seen kill a main character, and she's the baddie with the most screen time, none of the heroes care about her. Well, except for Jean. Jean, of course, has it out to get revenge, but to the rest of the cast, she seems to mean nothing. Adam and Hazel gets bigger reactions from the heroes than she does. None of them even bother trying to go after her after Weiss's stabbing. "Oh no, Cinder stabbed Weiss! Better keep dealing with Emerald and Mercury!" The rivalry she has with the protagonists is entirely one-sided. Most of the cast haven't even interacted with her. The only one who actively tries to pit themselves against her is also someone she doesn't even recognize. There's no relationship between the central villain and the heroes. And worst of all, the villains steal the show. The heroes don't get to participate in the final battle. Instead, we watch two villains fight each other. And that makes sense. They never gave over half the cast a motivation to want to fight the baddies. They've written it so that RWBY would rather play around with Mercury than go fight the main two villains of the volume. The heroes only even partake in the final battle because they had to. The kids didn't work towards anything, the bad guys did. RWBY is written so that the protagonists just wait around for the villains to do something. Of the whole cast, the bad guys are the ones with the most agency, and with 10 protagonists in the main cast, that's not a good thing. What fights? I've actually made a video about this topic before, which led me to realize that there are technically more fights in this volume than there were in Volume 4. However, almost half of them are comprised of their numerous cliffhangers at Menagerie. They draw out the attack at the Belladonna Mansion across 3 episodes for no reason. And not only is the encounter stretched out, but it also features the worst fight choreography and animation I've seen from the show. 10 seconds of cool gunchucks isn't enough to make me ignore how everyone had forgotten how to fight throughout the rest of the encounter. A common problem with the fights this volume is how over-choreographed they tend to feel. Similar to Yang's pre-volume short, the characters tend to just seem like they're going through rehearsed motions. There's no reaction time, everyone just knows exactly how and when to block every attack perfectly. Which has also rendered guns laughably useless. Roosterteeth's obsession with having characters sit still while one shoots and the other blocks each bullet with no effort is embarrassing. But I guess that's just what happens when you make talking the most important element of each fight. These characters insist on jabberjawing through each encounter as if the show was given to us in a written format. Combat has boiled down to being a moment of rapid movement to break up the countless pauses in action to chit-chat. Fight, stop, fight, stop, fight, stop. Everyone now has a hard-on for smashing their weapons together and then continuing to talk, as if that's as entertaining as actually fighting. No wonder they cut away from almost all the fights during the finale. They clearly don't know what they're doing to make any of them actually fun. I was willing to defend the choreography of Volume 4. Even without Monty, I believe that there were plenty of talented animators still working at Roosterteeth who could keep up the action in this action anime. But I guess they were all fired before Volume 5, because aside from 2 pretty good moments, the combat of this volume is the worst I've seen come out of the show. Volume 5 is technically the longest volume of RWBY so far, when combining each half of Volume 1's split parts together. When it was revealed that Volume 5 would have 14 episodes rather than the usual 12, I was super excited. A common thought I'd had while watching Volume 4 was, if only they had more time to dedicate to each of these character arcs. It seemed that they were always racing against the clock with Volume 4, resulting in half the arcs being rushed out or skipped entirely. But with 2 extra episodes this volume, that shouldn't be as much of a problem, right? Well, yes, but instead a new issue arose. Quite frankly, RT had too much time to fill and not enough content to fill it with. This results in episodes with bloated talking head scenes where characters meander across multiple unrelated topics until they finally get back on track. Everyone has the tendency to wait several full seconds before speaking, drawing out already boring conversations with dead air. It all happens so slowly that there are huge gaps in dialogue even when watching the show at times 2 speed. Another unfortunate element in all this is that directors seem to have forgotten that people can also move at the same time that they talk. The excessive amount of slow chit-chats are also done while the characters remain completely fucking still. This results in conversations that are as engaging to watch as Super Nintendo cutscenes. Sitting still and talking a lot would be a little excusable if it was in service of giving the audience important information towards the story or characters, but that's not what they did. Instead, we get to spend a whole volume recapping. The amount of times I mentioned the characters just talking about something the audience should already be aware of is downright unacceptable. People will often mention that it's better for a visual medium to show, don't tell, and that's true. You can just have us see a character be upset. You don't need the character to say, "I'm upset." The problem is, though, that in RWBY, they're just telling us about shit that they showed us earlier. If you're gonna have your characters talk so much, why would you choose to have them talk about events the audience already knows about? When the characters do finally stop reminiscing and choose to bring up something new for the audience, you'd think it'd be exciting. Oh boy, we're learning new information about Ozpin or Remnant! Except all this new information is bogged down by the monotonous pace of the dialogue and lackluster visuals of everyone sitting still. Learning important new information becomes a chore as the show prioritizes making scenes as long as possible with as little effort as possible. This volume could have been a fraction of the length it is. Cut out all the unnecessary pauses during dialogue, all the conversations that just recapped shit we already know, and all the superfluous scenes that made no impact on the story or characters, then the volume could have been 5 or 6 episodes long. It's mind-blowing that even though the kids are traveling the world collecting items and saving maidens, there's less content available in the volume than when they were at school dealing with bullies and who's gonna be Weiss's date to the dance. Now that the show is a fluid story rather than being episodic, the writers are scared to have anything happen throughout the volume. We can't let the characters do anything yet, otherwise they'd finish up the plot before the finale. RT's only willing to let the plot move or characters progress 4 episodes before the end of the volume, and that's not how this should work. Your characters should be active consistently throughout the story. Rather than just have them all sit around talking about past volumes, give your characters something to do. They need goals, they need motivations, they need to work towards something or have something happen to them, so that there's actually a story happening. As it is now, the show spends 9 episodes where the villains are setting up for the finale, while the heroes spend their screen time getting lectures from Ozpin. If you can't figure out how to keep your protagonists active throughout the story, then why the fuck would you choose to have so many episodes in the volume? If you won't let your heroes do anything until the last 4 episodes, then you don't need 14. I didn't think I'd like any volume of RWBY less than Volume 2. And then Volume 5 happened, with the boring, slow dialogues that offer nothing new and a level of fight quality worse than fan animation. Volume 5 has taken the title of Worst Volume, for me at least. I disliked Volume 5 so much that it's the only one I didn't purchase for Blu-ray or DVD. I felt Rooster Teeth didn't deserve to make money on such a disappointing product. The most frequent thought I had when I was first watching these episodes was, this feels like the first draft. Characters have no motivations beyond do what the script needs us to do. Events just happen without considering how they do or do not affect anything, and dialogue is devoid of character. It seems clear that this show is made by consumers of media, because the volume is riddled with things that need to be there because other shows have that. Zen meditating advice giver, check. Alcoholic mother that never cared backstory, check. Are you with us or against us? Check. Sad girl with implied dead mother, check. Villains have building laughter over the hero saying something confidently, check. This volume is so bloated with tropes that I'm surprised there's not a Hot Springs episode. The writers seem to struggle to have any original ideas for the show, to the point that characters completely morph and change depending on whatever cliche they need to fulfill. We like these characters, don't distort them into some archetype we've seen a million times before. Without interesting or diverse character writing to support the conversation-heavy volume, Rooster Teeth just decided to end half the episodes with a cliffhanger, most of which didn't even matter. What will happen when Emerald fights these bandits? Find out next time when we jump past the fight. Will Weiss die? Find out next time where we give her recovery minimal screen time. And you know, it's annoying. I don't like sitting here and writing 14 pages worth of complaints about RWBY. This show matters a lot to me, and I want to be able to go on and on about all the super cool things that happen in a volume. And it's annoying that this is what we got instead. A product that feels rushed out. Too preoccupied with making sure each episode is long enough to roll multiple ads on it than to give the show some life or originality. During this volume's original release, it seemed that Rooster Teeth cared more about promoting RWBY than actually making it. Look! RWBY's in blaze blue! We're releasing RWBY Chibi the day after this volume concludes. Make sure you watch that too! We've got merch! Buy all the merch! No matter the quality! RWBY's got a Japanese dub! Buy all those DVDs for anywhere between $45 and $70! Look! RWBY's gonna get an official manga in Shonen Jump! RWBY's getting a mobile game! Play that! And it's getting another mobile game that's only available in China, Hong Kong, Taiwan, and Macau! Look! RWBY's gonna be in Puzzle of Empires! Look! RWBY's getting a light novel! We're making a RWBY board game! RWBY's collaborating with Crusader's Quest! Making the show feels like a necessity to be able to continue to push the characters into other IPs and other forms of getting the same story as Volume 1 again. It sucks that it feels like the show went from a passion project to a merch machine. The part of the show with the most effort in it is its marketing. The character shorts have fluid animation and pretty lighting effects and actually contain some decent fight choreography, but it just feels like a ruse to get us to watch a show with a fraction of the quality put into it. The pretty lighting is replaced with flat shading. Animation grinds to a halt as the directors choose to have everyone afraid to move too much, and I think we've discussed the lackluster fights of the volume enough. The only episode of the whole volume with a semblance of the same level of effort in it is the first one. You know, the one Archie had people pay $12.50 to get to watch in theaters 2 days before its official release. The trailers should not be my favorite part of the volume, but RT only seems to want to put in the effort when it comes to selling the show rather than actually making it. If you want to see well-animated content with thoughtful fight scenes, intriguing character backstory, and fun interactions between the cast, then congrats! You only need to spend 13 minutes watching the trailers to get all that offered from the volume. Life's gonna suck when you grow up, when you grow up, when you grow up. Life's gonna suck when you grow up, it sucks pretty bad right now. Hey, if you know the words, sing along! You might have to go to war, shoot a gun, kill a nun. You might have to go to war when you get out of school. Hey, cheer up, kids, it gets a lot worse. You're gonna have to deal with stress, deal with stress, deal with stress. You're gonna be a giant mess when you get back from the war. Life's gonna suck when you grow up, when you grow up, when you grow up. Life's gonna suck when you grow up, it sucks pretty bad right now. You're gonna end up smoking crack on your back, face the fact. You're gonna end up hooked on smack and then you're gonna die. For that whole thing, I had something in my eye. It's probably hair. Hong Kong, Taiwan, and Macau. Look, RWBY's gonna be in Puzzle Empires. What? Everyone thinks it's better to dick around upstairs with Emerald and Mercury than go try to fucking handle Cinder. Whatever, whatever, fucking whatever. It's fine. It's fine. I'm going to assume that this was a fine take. And if it wasn't, tell me, and I'll re-record it. Assimilated into the friend group. Aw, shit. I hit my table. By the way, so I mentioned the merch. Buy all the merch, no matter the quality. Yeah, I think it'd be best if you have, like, a cup, like, one or two, like, of the nice-looking merch. Like, maybe one of their pretty figures, or a nice-looking shirt, you know? But then, no matter the quality, if you can have a picture of the ugly Pira doll, you know the one. The one literally no one bought, that one.